Hello, everybody. This is part two of three parts to the conservation biology topic, and we are going to be talking kind of briefly in this video about different conservation approaches, which I introduced in the last video, and then we'll also talk about how species are listed. So we're going to start with some of the conservation approaches that you've already learned. If you remember, we talked about species-specific approaches or species-level approaches in which conservation is focused on a particular species or perhaps a subspecies or something below that at the population level. Remember that conservation doesn't aim to do much beyond the species level, so you're never going to try to conserve an entire genus or an order or a family or a phylum or a kingdom as a whole. That just doesn't happen. And that would mean that conservation would be quite difficult to do. At the same time, we also talked a little bit about broader approaches, and those are focused more on large areas, habitats, or ecosystems rather than species. And there are arguments for or against both of those approaches. You can think of both of them as being equally valid, and both of them are being used currently by conservation biologists. Another big part that I want to introduce here is the IUCN Red List. I will introduce that first so that you can get an idea of what that means. We're going to talk quite a bit about the IUCN. And so let's quickly go through some of those basics. So how many of you have heard of the IUCN? I am sure very few, if any, of you have. And how many of you have heard of the Red List? That one might sound a little bit more familiar. So in 1964, the Red List was established by the IUCN. And the IUCN is the International Union for Conservation of Nature. It is essentially a group of people of various different backgrounds that are focused on conservation. Currently, the group is composed of about 7,500 different people, which includes scientists, other stakeholders that are policymakers. Mostly the IUCN partners with various groups that are focused on conservation. And there are many, many handfuls of different either nonprofit or for-profit associations that partner with the IUCN for a common goal. There is a video that I would like for you to watch. I'm not going to play it here in this video. The link is provided for you here, but I will also post it on our webpage, our Moodle page, and it gives you an idea of what the IUCN has been trying to do since its inception. The IUCN's been around since the 1940s, but the Red List itself hasn't been around since the 1960s. The Red List itself is a list of species that is published, and that list is updated continually. Since it's been around, we have added thousands upon thousands of different species to that list. And essentially, the list gives us an idea of where and how species are struggling. In order to get on the Red List, a species has to be assessed. And so we'll talk about the process very briefly that goes into a species getting listed. I do also want to mention that the IUCN Red List is a global database, a global list of species that pertains to the entire world and the entire globe in terms of biodiversity. It is not just focused on the United States. In the US, we have our own Endangered Species Act that aims to protect local or national species interests and local or national endangered or threatened species. Here we're going to talk about global approaches. What you will get to do as part of our group chat is a small assignment. I want you to go to the IUCN Red List webpage, which looks like this when you click on it, at iucnredlist.org. And what you will be able to do is type into the search field a name of a species. If you don't know what to look for, you can just explore the page as a whole. Every day, the IUCN publishes small profiles of a couple of new species that have been added to the Red List. So let's talk a little bit about the species that end up on that list. First, it is important to note that so far the IUCN has only assessed a little bit over 116,000 species. We know that there are at least 1.3 million species on our planet. So the IUCN has a lot of work to do, and their personal goal was to have at least 160,000 species added to their list of assessed species for the year. They are still working on this, and so you'll see updates every now and then of the new species that have been added. If we look at these four species that are presented on the homepage for today, you will notice that there's something called an African golden cat, a clover fern, an addax, and a spiny giant frog. And you will notice that for each of those species, there is a statement about its population as it currently stands. So the African golden cat is decreasing. And then you will see a code. The code is essentially an indication of how that species has been listed. We will talk about the different categories here in a moment, but the African golden cat is currently listed as vulnerable. If you look at the clover fern on today's webpage, it is stable in terms of its population, so it is not declining in the area that has been observed or assessed. So we will talk about these different categories, but I do want you to explore the IUCN website. And what I will do really quickly is show you what the website looks like. Here is the opening page, the front page of the IUCN website. And you will notice those four species that I just talked about. You can search for any species in the search field. And if you scroll down, you will notice that there's a little bit more information. It states here that more than 31,000 species are threatened with extinction. And that is 27% of all the assessed species. One thing that I want you to note is that not every single species on our planet has been assessed. Only 116 or so thousand have been assessed. And so we aren't really near where we should be in terms of understanding how different species are functioning in their ecosystems. We don't really know much about the majority of species on our planet. That also doesn't mean that every species that has been assessed is threatened. There are some that have been assessed that are perfectly fine. In fact, Homo sapiens has been assessed, and we are, of course, increasing. Our numbers are increasing, and we are perfectly fine. And then another thing to note is that there are species that are most likely threatened or nearing extinction that are not on the list, on the red list, and they are not assessed yet. So the goal of the IUCN is to gain a general understanding of all species on Earth, but we haven't gotten there yet. What you will notice on this website is that the highest group of organisms with the greatest threat level is amphibians. And we talked a little bit about the golden toad. Amphibians have faced a huge challenge, and that is mostly due to chytrid fungus. The second highest group on this list is conifers, coniferous trees. So things that you might be familiar with, species that belong in this group are pine trees or any kind of gymnosperm with cones, usually in the female form. Coral reefs is really high up on that list. If you've ever been to the coral reef systems, the one in Australia, the Barrier Reef, and then a really big one in the Caribbean, which is part of Belize, those coral reefs are at great risk of going extinct. And then if you look further on this list, you'll notice that mammals, sharks and rays, and even crustaceans are facing risks of extinction. If you scroll down on this page, you will also notice a little overview of the IUCN Red List and what it is. Of course, it was established in 1964, and it's become the world's most comprehensive information source of the global conservation status of animal, fungi, and plant species. And so I encourage you all, because I can't do this all in a PowerPoint presentation, to please go and read some of that background information. What we're going to do next is talk about the different categories on the red list. Let's take a look at what those categories are, and I'll come back to the web page. and I really encourage you all to look at it. On the red list, there are various categories, and those have been assigned to species based on their assessments that have been completed. An assessment is completed by a group of scientists or a group of interested people who actually have time to do field work and to study and monitor populations of a particular species. The highest category, and probably the scariest, is extinct. And extinct is usually coded with an EX. That suggests that there are no known individuals remaining anywhere on Earth and that the last individual has died. The second category from the top is extinct in the wild. We only know that species to survive in captivity, whether in a zoo or somewhere outside of its naturalized range in another small population. The next one down is critically endangered. And these animals or organisms, which could also be plants and fungi, are at extremely high risk of extinction in the wild. The next one down is endangered, EN, and these are species that are at a high risk of extinction in the wild. Vulnerable, VU, means that the species is at a high risk of endangerment in the wild. Near threatened, NT, means that the species is likely to become endangered in the near future. Endangered really just means that the species is exposed to some threat. Most of the time, those threats are man-made. Least concern is also usually coded by an LC, and that is the lowest risk. It does not qualify for a more at-risk category, and these are species that are widespread and abundant taxa. In fact, the majority of taxa probably that currently live on Earth fit into this category, but they haven't been assessed yet. Humans belong in the least concerned category. Then we have data deficient, DD. This means that the species that is being assessed is on the red list, but there's not enough data to make an assessment of its risk of extinction. And then the last category is not evaluated. What that often means is that the species has been added to the list of potentially assessed species, but it has not yet been evaluated against the list of criteria that are needed to be met in order to be listed. And one thing that I want you all to note is that in the context of the IUCN Red List, threatened is a term that we use to capture three different categories. If we say that a species is threatened, we are talking about critically endangered, endangered, and vulnerable species. Those three categories all fit into the threatened category or under the threatened umbrella. Here's another way of looking at the categories. Of the species that are evaluated, either we don't have enough data to put it in a category, or we do have enough data. And those data are usually things like, what is that species population size? How many mature individuals exist in that population that could potentially have offspring? How large is its geographic range? Is its range shrinking? Is it expanding, or is it remaining stable? There are also other things to consider, such as threats that are potentially exposing that species to the dangers of extinction. Once you have enough adequate data for a particular species, it gets listed in that red list as one of the categories that I just mentioned. Anywhere between least concern and extinct. And of course, as you move up that ladder from least concern to extinct, you are increasing the risk of extinction until the species is essentially gone. And remember that threatened categories include vulnerable, endangered, and critically endangered. What I would like for you to do in your spare time after you've watched this video is go back to the IUCN Red List website and take a peek at the more specific definitions of the different categories. It'll give you a better idea of how those species ended up in those categories. So one thing that I would like for you to do is to spend a little bit of time and find an organism that you like. First, I want you to give me the name of the organism, including its species name. Identify the red list category that that species is listed in. What is the existing population trend of the species? What is its known geographic range, its habitat, and its ecology, if that is known? Are there any recovery, monitoring, or action plans in place for that species? In other words, are we taking care of the conservation of that species? And what are the major threats that face the organism? Once again, let me go back to the IUCN webpage. Here are the categories again. Please scroll through these, and these should be able to help you understand a little bit more specifically what these different categories mean. But if we go to the top, we can search for a species. I am going to click on one of these that are on the front page. This African golden cat is really tickling my fancy, and you will notice that it is a mammal. It gives you the common name and the species name, as well as its population trend. But I want to know more about it. So if you click on a species, you will be taken to the species profile, which looks very much like this. So first, the African golden cat has been studied by a group of scientists, which are listed here in the citation. This species, as we noted before, is vulnerable. And if you scroll down, you will be able to find all the other important information. Here it shows us a map of the current geographic range of that species. In this particular case, it shows us where the species currently lives, and then potentially where it used to live and where potential extinct populations occur. And if you think about this, guys, that means that someone, scientists, are going out and monitoring these populations. That takes a lot of work. Someone is gathering all this data. So if you like research and you like to be out in the field, consider thinking about a career in which you could be doing some of this work. We don't have any information on the number of mature individuals, and that could be that they haven't really tagged these species. They haven't tagged individuals to track them well enough. But you can click on population in detail and find that out for yourself. They prefer forest ecosystems. All right, and then you will also notice that there are conservation actions in place. And then you can also look at some additional conservation information. So what is needed to preserve the species in its current state so that it doesn't keep declining? So that is a little task that I want you to complete, and I want you to bring your answers to the group chat. Please type out your answers. I might ask you to send me a typed out copy. Okay, and then I wanted to talk a little bit more about the species level approaches that we tend to take. I've talked about the red list, which helps us kind of keep an eye on which species need the most help. But oftentimes, we focus on organisms, when we think of conservation, that have larger impacts in their ecosystems. If you remember back to some of your introductory courses like Bio 161, you might have remembered the story about the gray wolf and how it was eradicated from a lot of different parts in the West. It was hunted almost to extirpation. The wolf today is seen as a keystone species. And if you remember what a keystone species is it's a species that is so critical to that particular ecosystem that if it gets removed, there is a trickle down of negative effects that impacts the entire ecosystem. When you bring back those keystone species and you focus on those in your conservation approaches, you can make really positive effects in an ecosystem as a whole. So this is a species level approach that has actually worked for us. Another type of species that might really help us make some really good conservation impacts is when we try to conserve or keep in mind umbrella species. This is the northern spotted owl, and umbrella species, which this is an example of, are those species that have a typically a large geographic range, an area in which they live. And the idea is that if you can focus conservation efforts on that one species, you are actually protecting all of the other species that live in that area as well. And so the umbrella species conservation approach is actually really, really smart. We have also documented these similar patterns in, say, mountain lions, which have really large home ranges where they hunt for food. The mountain lion, which is also known as a cougar or a puma, is both a keystone and an umbrella species. Removal of a mountain lion from an ecosystem has deleterious effects. Now, there are some species that are sometimes called keystone or umbrella species for which conservation efforts have not really been successful. The black rhino in Africa has been a focus of conservation, and scientists have realized that conserving or focusing conservation efforts on that species hasn't really improved the conservation of other species that live in its same range. So we can't always make these generalized statements about these species. In addition, when I talked about broader approaches, I was talking about those that focus not just on a species or that use a species as a proxy for a larger area, but the approaches that actually use ecosystems or hotspots and focus on those instead of individual species. So if you visit the IUCN website again, this is a different part of their work, and this is relatively new. The IUCN, as of late, has begun to build a red list of ecosystems, and this is quite fascinating. There are areas on our planet that have actually been assessed, and those areas, generally speaking, give us information about the species that might be living there. So I'm going to show you an example of what this ecosystem red list actually looks like. And we're going to go here. So I'm going to click on one of these areas. Let's click on this. This is Madagascar. And I'm going to click on this little bubble. And it says the ecosystem is tapia forest. And they assessed this in 2013. They did a single assessment. And the country is Madagascar. And what they're doing here is focusing not on a species, but you'll notice that the same risk level has been associated with an ecosystem instead, or a habitat. And this says that a forest comprising an evergreen canopy of 10 to 12 meters with an understory of ericoid shrubs. They discuss what kinds of plants live there. They talk about this endemic species. We will talk about that here in a second. The tapia, which is what this forest is named after, is an endemic species valued for its edible fruit. And also the bark is used in Malagasy folk medicine. So a lot of information about plants. And here is a group of scientists, Moat and Bachman in 2013, who actually did the work, and they published this in a journal. But think about the importance of not just species, but focusing conservation efforts on areas instead of individual species. And you all will notice that a lot of work has been done here in Australia. You will notice that the United States doesn't really have a whole lot going on. What's going on there? I encourage all of you to get involved in this as you think of careers. So the United States literally has nothing happening at the moment. The only place in North America that has been assessed is this part of the Great Lakes, right on the border of the US and Canada. One last thing that I wanted to mention to you all is that much of the focus in conservation has been on areas called hotspots. You may have heard this term before. We sometimes throw it around as biologists very casually. There are various hotspots that have been designated specifically as really biodiverse rich areas in the world. And these hotspots are marked in red on this map. You will notice that there are a couple in the United States, mostly out west. And then a lot of the hotspots are focused around the tropics or the equator and the subtropics. You will notice that northern latitudes don't really have much hotspot activity going on there. And it could be that we just haven't assessed those areas very well. One interesting thing about hotspots is that Currently, there are about 34 that have been identified in the world. That number varies depending on who you talk to and how a hotspot is defined, but those areas hold 50% of all of our vascular plant diversity. And if you remember what a vascular plant is, it's one that requires vascular structure, so stems, leaves, roots, in order to function. Really, any of the plants that you're familiar with, a moss, for example, would not be a vascular plant. And 42% of terrestrial vertebrates live in these hotspots. So if you can focus your conservation efforts on a hotspot or hotspot areas, you are taking care of a lot of your biodiversity already. And these hotspots, if you measure out the amount of land that they occupy, is only about 2.3% of the world's entire land surface. One last thing that I want to note about hotspots, which we will talk about a little bit more in our chat session, is that hotspots are known to contain or to host endemic species. I mentioned endemic species when we looked at that website just a moment ago. Endemic species are defined as those that live in only a very small or a very restricted geographic area. And I've picked four examples of different critters that I really enjoy, that I really like. You might recognize three of them, except for the top left one, that's one that you might not have seen. So Dryocoscelis australis is this long, about 8-inch walking stick-like insect that is found on a small island in the middle of Australia and New Zealand in the Tasman Sea. And this species was for a long time thought to be extinct, and it was rediscovered. Now, if you go to some of the museums in Australia, they're actually trying to bring these populations back. And so they've taken eggs from the wild and they've been breeding them. The ring-tailed lemur, Lemur catta, is found only in Madagascar. It exists nowhere else. In fact, Madagascar is one of the biggest endemism hotspots in the world. Most of the species that live in Madagascar live only there. And you might want to think a little bit about why species in Madagascar are endemic, or why species in, say, Australia are endemic. If you think about the koala, why would a koala be endemic only to Australia? Part of that has to do with isolation of the area from different parts of the world. If a species has been isolated and there's no way for that species to move or migrate to another place on Earth, that typically ends or results in endemism. Finally, on the bottom left, we've got Amblyrhynchus cristatus, which is a marine iguana, and that one, you can probably guess, is found in the Galapagos Islands. They're really quite hideous creatures, but they're really neat biologically. They can swim, hence marine iguana. And we can talk a little bit more about these critters later. But four examples of endemic species, endemic meaning that they live only in those areas and nowhere else. It also means that those species, because they have such small geographic ranges, or they live in only one small place on Earth, they tend to be at a very high risk of extinction. And this is why hotspots tend to be areas that we focus on in terms of conservation, planning, monitoring, and so on. Those areas that exist on the IUCN website that are focused on these ecosystems, you will notice, are also typically correlated with areas that are hotspots. Hence, the reason why we don't really have much work being done in the United States. We don't really have many endemic populations of species. So we have basically covered the bases in terms of conservation approaches. So we have basically completed the second part of conservation. And we've talked a little bit about the IUCN Red List and how that Red List has helped us make certain conservation decisions. I know we didn't talk about all the details. We would have to spend many, many weeks on this to really fully understand what the great scope of work is that the IUCN is attempting to do. And we also talked about species level versus large, broader level approaches that are more focused on ecosystems, habitats, hotspots, etc. And one last thing that I wanted to do was finish out and talk about the traditional goals of conservation, because in our next video, we are going to finally be talking about how phylogenies are tied into conservation, because the goals of phylogenetic conservation are quite different. So you can pause and see if you can answer these questions without looking at what I have put on the slides. But what do you think are the traditional goals of conservation? What are we trying to do? First, the idea is that we should try to conserve as many species as possible and maintain species richness. If you remember, species richness is the number of unique species that are found in an area. That is different from species diversity, which is a measure of both richness and the evenness of those species. These are concepts that you might have seen in introductory biology. In addition, the idea is that we conserve areas with the highest species richness. So not just as many species as possible, but areas with the highest species richness. And these might include places like hotspots. And I also have in here wilderness areas. These are places that are protected, that are untouched, that are left to their own devices. So nature can do with those places what it will. Those areas tend to be really high in species richness because they don't have a lot of human development and human influence impacting the species that live there. This is in part why limiting human impact in certain areas is really important. If you think of our national park system, that is in place because it allows us to preserve species that live there without human impacts. And we're not allowed to collect or utilize resources in those areas. And finally, probably the biggest goal of conservation is to prevent the extinction of species. So the big idea here is that we want to prevent extinction of species, which means that we have to conserve areas with the highest species richness and conserve as many species as possible. So this is a lofty goal, something that conservation biologists are always striving to do, but keep this in mind because those goals might change depending on how you look at conservation. So I will see you at the next video. Please come with questions, and I will see you soon. Take care.